Welcome back, everybody, to Gemology for Schmucks. My name is Peter Nelson, and today we're going to talk about one of the most important misconceptions that people have about gemstones. We're going to be talking about the Mohs Hardness Scale. A lot of people ask me questions about this or bring up statements trying to show that they're in the know about gemstones using the Mohs scale. So before we get too far into this, let's clarify everything. The Mohs scale is a scale used for describing the hardness of a gemstone. So what is hardness? Hardness is the scratchability of a gemstone, whether or not something can be scratched by other materials. What you need to understand about the Mohs scale is that it is not an objective scale. And what that means is that 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, those are not equal increments. The geologist who created the Mohs scale, Mr. Mohs, actually selected certain minerals to be his number 1, his number 2, all the way up to number 10, based on this mineral can be scratched by this mineral. This mineral can be scratched by this mineral. And so the numbers just relate to what levels can be scratched by other levels. Anything at, let's say, 7, which is quartz, cannot be scratched by things that are below it. Can they be damaged by those things? Well, I mean, if you drop a metric ton of something on something that is harder than it, yes, it can still be damaged. It just won't be scratched. An objective scale of hardness would be something like the Knoop scale, which, yes, I did look it up. The K is pronounced. It's Dutch. The Knoop scale is much more objective because what they do is they take a very specifically shaped diamond point, and then they put a specific load behind it and press into it over a specific amount of time. And then they measure the depth of the indentation that that point creates. And so that gives you a very specific and very objective number of the hardness of a material. Using the Knoop scale, the Mohs scale, number 1 through 7, are all under 1,000. Number 8 is just over 1,000 Knoop's hardness. And then number 9 is over 2,000 Knoops. So you've got everything almost in this block, and then you've got the next jump up being right here, and the next jump up being up here. So that's almost double. And then at the top of the Mohs hardness scale is diamond. Now the distance between diamond and corundum, which is number 9 on the Mohs scale, is all the way up here at 8,000. It doesn't even fit on the screen anymore. So we've got 8,000 with diamond, 2,000 with corundum, a little bit over 1,000 for topaz, and everything else is inside of 1,000 on the Knoop scale. So it's very much so not an objective scale. So why do we use the Mohs scale if it's so ridiculous? Well, because it's functional for our purposes. The two most common minerals in the world are feldspar, things like moonstone, for example, and quartz. Now, quartz is more plentiful in the area where humans actually inhabit. It's actually in the dust that's all over your apartment if you're a little bit lax in cleaning. And so what that means is that if you've got rings on, for example, and you've got something that is less hard than quartz, that means it can be scratched by quartz. And if you've got a ring on and you're like, well, that's got a smudge on it, I think I'll just clean it off right there. Well, there's quartz in your clothes. That means that every time you go to polish your clothes, if it's softer than quartz, then you're actually removing the quality of the polish a little bit. You're scratching it with tiny, tiny scratches. And over time, that's going to take the quality of the polish and the quality of the facet junctions and diminish them. But don't worry, not all is lost. Even if you do have a stone that is softer than quartz, which is the 7 on the Mohs scale, you can still get your stone repolished. You can take it to a jeweler or a lapidary and they can put a new polish on it. And that's something we'll talk more about the details of when we talk to my lapidary friend in a future episode. Now there are so many gemstones with lots of history, lots of popularity that are softer than quartz, that are softer than that 7 on the Mohs scale. Things like peridot, for example. Things like tourmaline. Things like jade. But that's all right. We don't need to disregard things that are softer than quartz. But think about it. If you're wearing a pendant or if you're wearing earrings or something that's more out of the way, maybe a bracelet, that's going to take less abuse than something that's going to be directly on your hands, especially if you talk with your hands like me. So let's use the Mohs scale just to inform our choice of how we use gemstones in jewelry. I think that's a much more efficient way to go. Many things are beautiful but a little bit soft. Now, hardness is not everything. In a previous episode, I said that a gemstone has to be beautiful, rare, and durable. And durability is not all hardness. Diamond, for example, we said that was an 8,000 on the Knoop scale. However, just because diamonds are the definition of a very hard mineral, some people even argue it's the hardest mineral, there are harder out there, but just because diamonds are hard does not mean that they are incredibly durable. If you take diamonds and you throw it on the ground, it will still chip. Remember that hardness is defined as scratchability. durability is more than just whether or not a stone can be scratched. There's something else that we call toughness or tenacity, and that's the ability of something to get chipped. Diamonds can chip. Diamonds have a characteristic called cleavage, which is basically a weakness across an atomic plane. So if you press on it in the wrong direction, in that direction of weakness, then it can actually split in sheets. A great example of this is mica. If you've ever seen mica, it comes in what's called a book. It's actually just sheets upon sheets of the same mineral because it's got weaknesses in those atomic planes. That's very strong cleavage, mind you. Diamonds do not have cleavage that is perfect, so it's less likely to chip like mica. Mica, it's almost guaranteed to happen. So what are some gemstones that are tough? The toughest gemstones in the world are actually the two types of jade. Jadeite, which I'm wearing right here. And I've also got another piece right here, which is nephrite jade. Nephrite jade is the jade of antiquity. So if you go to places like China or even BC in Canada, you'll find that there are axes from traditional people there because it is such a tough mineral. Once they could get the stone into the shape of an axe with an edge on it, they could chop and chop and chop and chop and it would not wear down like other stones would. In Chinese, they call it 天玄难断玉. So that's basically the stone that is even difficult for the heavens to break. And they've got a long and rich history in China, not only of using this as a tool, but also as a ceremonial stone. And that's all the tenacious soft jade known as nephrite. On the Mohs scale, nephrite is only about a 6 or 6.5, and jadeite is a 6.5 to 7. So jadeite is a little bit harder, but it's a little bit less tough than nephrite. How about that? So think about that next time you're shopping around for gemstones. Jade is a stone that symbolizes tenacity, an ability to get beat on and beat on and beat on, but still withstand that kind of adversity. That's symbolism right there. So let's take a quick review. The Mohs hardness scale is a measure of how easy it is for something to be scratched. If you're thinking about whether or not something is easily scratched, always go back to that number 7, the perfect number. Quartz. Quartz is plentiful in the air, and so it is also plentiful in the dust. If you're trying to polish off a piece of jewelry, you're scratching your stone if it's softer than quartz. So that's 7 and below. Scratchability is not the same thing as toughness and durability. There's also toughness or tenacity, and some stones that are not very hard can be super tenacious. And stones that are softer than quartz maybe are better off being used as earrings or as a pendant and not as rings. That said, if you're less brutal than I am, then feel free to wear your stones wherever you would like. All right, thank you for joining me on this episode of Gemology for Schmucks. If you enjoyed this, please hit that like button, that subscribe button, and tell all of your friends about it. And enjoy this time of lockdown. Use it as a time of learning. Use it as a time to remind yourself why you loved your loved ones. Try not to strangle them. I understand it's difficult being in close quarters. And I will see you next time. Bye-bye.